Hachette Audio presents Mike's Election Guide, written and read by Michael Moore.
This audiobook is dedicated to Tony Benn, the former Member of Parliament in Great Britain, and to Shirley Chisholm, my first vote for president in April of 1972. Introduction. Sam Graves of Missouri has a problem. He's a Republican and a member of Congress, and he's scared he may lose his seat in this year's election. So he had an idea. He produced a TV ad where he doesn't mention that he's either a Republican or a member of Congress. He believes that if the voters don't know either of these things about him, his chances of winning re-election are greatly improved. How did we reach a point where a Republican from the South is frightened for his political life, afraid to even tell anyone he's a Republican? How did the word Republican replace liberal as the dirtiest word in politics? Republican Congressman Tom Davis of Virginia sums up the problem this way. The Republican brand is in the trash can. If we were dog food, we'd be taken off the shelf. After a disastrous war, the failure to catch bin Laden, millions of families who've lost their homes, the Katrina debacle, soaring gas prices feeding record oil company profits, and the largest national debt caused by the biggest spending and borrowing administration in American history, the country has had it with conservatives, right-wingers, and Republicans. A thrilling election season is now upon us. Obama versus McCain. One candidate has promised a presidency different from any other, one that will take us forward to embrace the hope of the 21st century. The other candidate says he has no idea how to use a computer. Welcome to Mike's Election Guide, my effort to make sense of this fall's race for the White House and Congress. Herein I answer the nation's most pressing questions. Why is John McCain so angry? Do the Democrats still drink from a sippy cup and sleep with the light on? Can I get into the Electoral College with only a 2.0 grade point average? And how many Democrats does it take to lose the most winnable election in American history? It's a great year to be an American and a voter. Don't miss out on all the fun. And if you see Congressman Sam Graves of Missouri, give him a big shout out. Yo, Republican! Charles Bukowski once said that the difference between a democracy and a dictatorship is that in a democracy you vote first and take orders later. In a dictatorship, you don't have to waste your time voting. Tom Stoppard once said that it's not the voting that's democracy, it's the counting. Chapter 1. Ask Mike. Wherein I answer questions on the street from the American people about voting, the 2008 presidential candidates, and the issues facing the nation. Gladys Seipel of Gatlinburg, Tennessee asks, I'm doing my best to support the troops, but I just can't make up my mind. Should I buy a magnetic yellow ribbon for the back of my car, or should I simply fly a big American flag on the back of my Dodge Ram? Well, Gladys, the big magnetic yellow ribbon with the imprint, Support Our Troops, seems to be the popular choice. Although there are reports that on lesser model Pontiacs, the paint under the decals tends to bubble up and explode, most consumer Americans have been quite satisfied with them. It gives them a certain patriotic feeling. But even more, it allows the consumer American to do something that contributes significantly to the war effort. And nothing says I sacrificed like a big magnetic yellow ribbon on the back of your kick-ass SUV. The great thing about the magnetic sticker is that you don't have to permanently affix it to your nice new car. Why risk having to spend $20 on some touch-up paint if you try to peel a real sticker from it? I mean, you know, we love America and all, but $20 is $20. Plus, with all the shopping we've done to defeat the terrorists, why make this whole sticker thing more trouble than it needs to be? I'm worn out just thinking about it. This patriotism business can be exhausting. But we do it anyway. We do it because we know how good it makes our troops feel. Riding around in Baghdad, though they may not be fully protected with the armor that we promised them, at least the soldiers know that the America they are protecting is full of people on their way to the outlet mall with big yellow magnetized shoutouts next to their Bite Me, I'm Yours bumper stickers. Of course, many of those with these yellow ribbons oppose paying the necessary taxes to fund the war and thus leave this debt behind for their grandchildren. But heck, that's what grandchildren are for. And what quadriplegic vet doesn't get all misty-eyed when he looks out the window of his rat-infested room at the Walter Reed Annex and sees a patriotic decal on the back of a Mercedes as it whizzes by on its way to Chevy Chase? It almost makes him want to re-up for Uncle Sam. And while 400,000 vets wait in line for their disability claims from this war, they can at least take some comfort from the sea of ribbons flowing down the street. Sure, these vets are finding it hard to get a job, and thousands have come back to find their boss handing them a pink slip. But I know that many of them have a real sense of satisfaction, knowing that the country they went to fight for has sent their jobs, including the job of making magnetic yellow ribbon decals, to China. One vet has this suggestion for a 2009 version of the magnetic yellow ribbon. Have it read, "Support our troops," on one part of the ribbon, and "Bring them home" on the other. Chuck Thompson of Greenwich, Connecticut wants to know, if Iran has weapons of mass destruction, we should invade, right? Excuse me? Did you say the words weapons of mass destruction? Take it back. I said take it back. I swear to God, if I hear those words once more in my lifetime, I'm going to punch somebody. And I'm a pacifist. No greater lie was ever spoken to the American people than the lie that Iraq had weapons of mass destruction. That whopper bamboozled the country into war, a war that has brought death and injury to countless Iraqis and Americans. The vast majority of Americans initially supported the war and gave Bush an approval rating of 70%. That's how good of a lie it was. So here's my new policy. If any president or general or cable news pundit, are you listening, Wolf, says that country X has weapons of mass destruction, or is building them, or is thinking of getting them, or was seen shopping at the weapons of mass destruction mall, I'm going to say plain and simple, you, sir, are lying. My automatic assumption will be that not only am I being lied to, I'm being played big time so that Uncle Sam's hand can dig into my pocket and grab my money to pay off the latest batch of military contractors. I will not care how many speeches you make, how many cartoon drawings you show to the members of the United Nations. I don't care how much evidence you claim to have or how many network reporters you've snookered. I will never, ever believe you. On the outside chance that there may be a legitimate threat to the United States, I will not be convinced of such a threat until I actually see it with my own two eyes. You can claim Iran has a nuclear weapons program all you want, but I will not believe it. For me to believe it, that Ahmadinejad guy would literally have to walk onto the stage of American Idol with a very bomb itself in his hands. Seriously, I will have to actually see the friggin' bomb, and then I want him to show me that he knows how to use it. Of course, I don't want him to actually detonate the thing. At least not before they announce who's being cut from this week's Idol. Then, and only then, will I believe. But belief alone won't be enough to get me to do anything about it. Why should I? 9 other nations have the bomb, and we've done nothing about that. We've let all the old Soviet missiles be scattered over who knows where, so why start to pretend that we now give a hoot? A wise man, I.F. Stone, once said, "Every government is run by liars, and nothing they say should be believed." Our lazy, useless, gullible media starts with the assumption that the government is telling them the truth. And only when someone from outside the mainstream presents the evidence that a lie has been told do the journalists get off their butts and investigate anything. After 8 years of a lying administration, you'd think the media would start with the assumption that their chain is getting jerked again. Will I ever live to see the day when just one reporter at a White House press conference stands up and says the following? Based
on what We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.